It gives me enormous joy for me to come to school than any other place for various reasons. A, I am a granddaughter of a school teacher. B, I am a daughter of a professor. C, I am the daughter-in-law of a school teacher. D, I am a teacher. I used to teach computer science in Christ University. And later I became so irregular than my own students. Then I said I will come on a management than a teacher because of my hectic schedules. Children give me enormous joy because they are innocent. And this is the first time I'm addressing any school in Bombay. I have not addressed any school in Bombay. I have come only for them. I have only come to Bombay for meetings, never to a school. So when there was an urgent meeting came down today, evening I have a 7 o'clock meeting, then I thought, why can't I come little early? Anyway, I waste half a day in Bangalore traffic reaching airport. I rather leave at 5 in the morning, reach Bombay at 8:30, so that I can have a session with the students, and that then I opted for this. I'll tell you a small story. I am a grandmother of 2 grandkids. Like today's how grandkids are there, they are like that, normal, okay? That means more talking and less listening. And my granddaughter's name is Krishna, and she told me, they live in London. One day I told her to eat banana fruit. You know, we India consider it's a good fruit. Eat, and then she said, me, Ajji, give me law. She calls me Ajji, like any Kannada grandmother is called, or Maharashtrian grandmother is called. She said, Ajji, give me a set of reasons why one should eat banana, a 5 years kid, okay? I said, okay, I will tell you a story, and then you feel like eating, you eat. I said, there was a rishi by the name Durvasa. I'm sure most of you know. Durvasa is a fellow, wherever he goes, he gives shapa, you know, he curses. He gets so upset so fast. So there was a rishi by the name Durvasa who was a very short-tempered fellow. Whenever he used to go to anybody's place, they used to get scared of him. Why this fellow has come, let him go as early as possible. I'm sure when you are not a nice person, nobody welcomes you. One day his wife told him, look, people, when you go, people run away. Whereas I stayed with you for such a long time, don't you think I deserve a boon or a special gift? First he was very upset. Then he said, okay, fine, I'll give you a special gift. What do you want? She said, I want a fruit which is not grown in Devaloka or up above heaven, which is grown on the earth. Yet it should be used to worship God. B, it should flower once a year and it should not have any seeds. C, all parts of that tree should be used in cooking. D, it should give fruits only once in a year, and the fruits should be not messy kind, you know, like not like a mango or apple. And such fruit, without giving that to God, the puja will be incomplete. He said, okay. He made a tree and gave the flower, fruit to the God, and then he called that, her name was Kadali, so he called that fruit the Kadali Phala. Kadali in Sanskrit became banana in English later. So whatever banana tree you see, that is the intelligence of a woman who told her husband the kind of fruit which is easy to eat, whose leaves are used for eating, whose bark is in the stem is used in cooking, whose flower is used in a cooking, which flowers once a year, and there are no seeds. So I told, it's such a great fruit on the earth. If you don't want to eat Krishna, you don't have to eat. But only learned people eat this one. Suddenly Krishna became, you know, upset. No, I want to be a learned person, and took the banana and ate. What I'm telling you is, though, you know, every generation, it's really wrong to tell that our generation has a lot more stress. That is totally wrong. Parents, please remove it from your head in case you have such things. I was in Egypt about 15 years back. Then I took on Egyptology, that is a very a person who knows how to read hieroglyphy, who knows more about Egyptian history, and went to one place which is 7,000 years old, and there I saw the pyramid. Inside the pyramid there was hieroglyphy, so I asked that fellow, what it is written here, you tell me. This fellow told me, the builder of Egypt pyramid have written about next generation. Next generation is, doesn't respect time, doesn't respect money, doesn't respect elders. They have less common sense, they are less hardworking. I really do not know how they will survive. Suddenly I felt like, you know, my parents talking to me like that. Every generation feels next generation is less than ours. We are very hardworking, we talk. No, that is really not true. Every generation has their own plus and minus, some totally same. Any mathematics teacher or any students who love mathematics will appreciate this. What is 1 by 2? Half. 1 by 2 is 2 by 4. It is also equal to 3 by 6. It is also equal to 4 by 8. It is also equal to 16 by 32. The moment I say 1 by 2 and 16 by 32, 16 is a huge number, 1 is small, but the ratio remains the same. And that is the way every generation has their own plus, minus, their own strengths. Okay, their own stress. In olden days, how parents were worried, I know. I have seen my great-grandmother, my grandmother, my mother and me, and my daughter, you know, 6-7 generation I have seen. They were always worried about disease because there was no antibiotic in those days. If the child gets fever, the mother would have been panicked. Today you go to a pediatrician, in those days it was not there. Next generation I have seen there was no connectivity. Coming to Bombay is once in lifetime, particularly from people from Karnataka. Every generation undergoes a different stress, but they do undergo stress. Now coming to this topic, they told me that you have to address student, parents. I said I wanted to address students actually, but if parents are interested, I can. But students may get bored. But I want to tell something to students and then I will address parents. Students, you should understand one thing. When you are in school, somebody looks after you. Your teacher, your parents look after you. They will tell you some good words and you really get bored. When they start sermon, your mind goes away somewhere. Because I was also a student once upon a time. Too many things someone tells you, then you won't like it, actually. You won't like it. And too many things we should not tell also. If we want to tell parents, you should always tell in the form of a story. Never tell directly. You should be hardworking. Always tell a story because that is more effective. As a child, you may not like it. But please remember, people who care for you only will tell. Third person will not tell. In our hierarchy, in Indian tradition, we say first Matru Devo Bhava, because mother is the one who is closest to you, she will tell. Then it's a father, Pitru Devo Bhava. And third one is Acharya Devo Bhava. Acharya means not Pandit or Bharji. Acharya means teacher who teaches you. Teacher cares for you. Please remember, a good teacher cares for you. And later, you know, in college life, no teacher tells you. Because it doesn't matter you pass or fail. As a college teacher, I knew I have to go complete my syllabus and I will get my salary, I will come back. But in school, it won't happen because this is the impressive years you are undergoing from LKG to 10th standard here. Good 14 years up to ISE if you go. Good 14 years of your life. There are always teachers and they are third in the hierarchy who care for you. Please remember, someone cares for you have the authority to scold you also. And they tell in the right way, please don't underestimate your parents and your teachers. It's your duty to understand what they are telling, for what reason they are telling. And you have to actually accept it. And later it will pay its price later part of your life. What you don't learn now will never be learnt later. It is always false ideas. When I grow big, you know, I will do. I don't know how many of you have read my book, The Story of Portado. I don't know, the day. I won't remember which book I read, the day I stopped drinking milk. Somewhere, I know, I want to give that incident. It's 1:30, up to 2 I will finish. Then the remaining time I will give for question answers. Portado, it's a real life story. Portado was my classmate. He was reasonably bright, maybe very bright, I suppose. Never came to school, never came to college. I was in engineering college. He used to stay, he was from Goa. He used to come, he was in the hostel and he never used to come to college. Our college was 7 to 11, he will come around 10 o'clock or 9 o'clock, earliest mean 9 o'clock. And he will sit here, sit there, attend two classes. After that, afternoon he will come for the lab, etc. End of the year, he will, 1 month he will get up early and he will study. And you know, there is a method in college. You take question papers, April and October. Whatever comes in October will never come in April. Okay? I'm sure in the school also you have. Midterm will never come to final. Okay? So eliminate these question answers and then make an approximate question paper and study that, and he used to get a first class. He did all 4 years like this. Once I asked Potato, Potato, why you are such a bright person? You don't come to class. If you come regularly, you can get distinction. You can get a rank. He said, Sudha, you do not know. In life, it is not the education. It is the connection it really works. And we have to build a lot of connections, you know, in when you are young, it helps you. I came from a middle-class family. My father was a doctor, a gynecologist. I never understood this connection, all those things. Then he said, my father was in military. We were in Calcutta. There was a club, which we have never seen in our real life. So we thought maybe he's a big man, and it is beyond our... Hamara bas ka baat nahi, I felt. So it's something new. Years passed. In 1972, I finished my engineering, so was Potato, and I didn't meet him for a long time. After 30, 35 years, I think 2008 or 9, I had been to Dubai to deliver a lecture. And when the lecture was over, I saw somebody waiting for him. And then he said, ma'am, I was waiting for you. I was surprised, a place like Dubai, who will wait for me? Then he said, I am Potato. I could not recognize, because in 30, 40 years, people put on weight, your hair will be gray. You know, all those physical changes will happen. So I said, Potato, I would not have recognized. I was very happy. I told him, oh, let us sit down and talk. He said, no, I just wanted to tell you one word to you. So I was waiting. I said, what happened? He said, you know, do you remember in college I used to bunk class? I said, of course I remember you, Potato means bunking class. He said, I used to bunk class and I joined a job, and because in those days, the moment you have BE, you used to get a job in my time. And my bosses came to know that, my subordinates came to know that I don't have knowledge. Getting a first class marks are different than knowledge. Please remember, parents, your children should be in the pursuit of knowledge than the marks. Though it's a competitive examination. I agree. It is a competitive world. It is a competitive world. Competition is 1,000 times or 10,000 times more than what time I had. But with all those things, the knowledge which always helps you than your marks in real life. So he said, I got marks, but I did not have knowledge. Once the subordinates know that you don't have knowledge, they don't respect you. Once the boss knows you don't have knowledge, then he wants a reason to kick you out. I was kicked out from one job, then I took a second job. And I was so much used to getting up 9 in the morning, I'll go late to the office. I was kicked out there also. Over a period of time, I couldn't get job anyway. And now I have a job as a manager job or a smaller job in Dubai. And I said, what about your family? He said, I have 2 daughters. I left them in Chennai to study. I said, what? He said, yes, I want they should study well. They should not become like me. I just waited for you to tell Sudha one thing. When we were young, I used to make fun of you. He used to tell me, you are like a running race horse, because the horse will see neither left nor right, it runs. Same way, you always were academic and we used to make fun of you. Today, when we called you nerd, and I thought I was very smart, you know, today I feel you are successful and I wasted my life. I just wanted to tell you, if you don't discipline when you are school or in college, you pay a heavy price in later part of your life. Discipline, like coming up in a proper way, writing properly, okay, talking properly, communicating properly, respecting people properly, this really helps a long way in your life. So I don't want, you should be like Potato, regretting in your old age. You should remember that to be successful in life, there is no shortcut. The only method is hard work and straight way. And that you have to do. And remember one more part, that your school, you come as a raw product to school, like a raw material to school. School churns you out 14 years and takes you out as a finished good. You come out as a young toddler here, you go out as a fine teenager. The school has done so much, not for the fees what you give. Your fees are minimal when you compare to the kind of advantage you get in real life. Your teachers, your parents, everyone put so much hard work to make you a young teenager. Please remember, the school is your alma mater. And when you grow big, when you make money more than what you need, you should always help your alma mater, because that is the place which has given you a life in real life. This I wanted to tell you. The budget of Harvard University is more than the Pakistan's national budget. The budget of Harvard University is run by its old students. Alma mater, they have old students in every university in US. Even in India, we have started that. But it is run by the past students who give their enormous wealth back to their college, because college or school does great work to make a fine human being. So the role of a teacher, role of a student is very important. My grandfather was a school teacher, I told you before. He was a high school teacher, and we lived in a village. So in the evening, both of us used to sit on the, outside the village, there will be a small park, in front of our house. We used to sit there, and people who pass our house used to tell, "Namaste, Master Ji," everybody. Once I asked my grandfather, maybe 7-8 years old, why do they call everyone, including the Patel of the village, including the Mukhiya, everyone says, "Namaste, Master Ji," why? My grandfather told me a very nice shloka from Mahabharata. He told, Arjuna, the great, mighty warrior, the great warrior, always used to respect his teacher Dronacharya. And somebody asked him, "Oh Arjuna, you are such a famous man. You are a king. You have a lovely wife. You have so much wealth. Why do you always worship your teacher who doesn't have even any money compared to you?" He says, "That is not true. Na rajyam." That's the reason I want you should introduce Sanskrit, because it's one of the most beautiful language of our land, which has great classics like this, which tells you, na rajyam, na dhanam, na kanakam. That means it says, no kingdom, neither a beauty nor money. In this life, nothing stays with you. The most beautiful person today become old one day. Today, whatever you see, Deepika Padukone, she will become old one day. In my time, Vaijanthimala was so beautiful. She also became old one day. Old age is a part of life. People who were very rich once upon a time may not remain like that, because money is always wavering. People who had a lot of lands might have lost lands due to many reasons. So in life, nothing is permanent. What is permanent? He says, knowledge is permanent. Knowledge nobody can steal, nobody can burn, nobody can bury. Knowledge is something, the more you give, the more wealthy you become. As a teacher, I'm sure all teachers will agree, first year we are not great teachers. Second year will be a better teacher. Third year, perfect teacher. Because every year you go on teaching, you know your flaws. Not students will tell, but we know our flaws when you teach. Was I really fast? Was I condensing? Was I not convincing? You learn your faults every year and you improve. And that's the reason the more you teach, better teacher you become. More knowledge you give, better person you become. So he says the teacher is the one, he's the greatest philanthropist. He or she may not have much money, but a teacher is the one, the greatest philanthropist in life, who gives away their knowledge to others. And that's the reason we should always respect teachers. And teachers are the most important people in your life. Please remember that. Coming to parents now, my granddaughter asked me, "Aji, were you young any time in your life?" I said, "Yes, beta, once upon a time I was also young, Because they have not seen me as young person. I was like you, young woman once upon a time with the small children in the school. And one thing I learned, there are two, three types of competition. One is competition in the market, okay, or in the school, or in the field. Most parents will have competition with their children. What is your son scored? I never ask that one. How much your son scored and how much my son scored and compare. Don't do that. It is not good for you and worse for your child. Every flower is beautiful, but it's in own way. You cannot say rose is better, hibiscus is not. No, hibiscus has its own property, its own color, its own volume, and it looks different. Every child is a flower by himself or herself. Do not compare. And you know, when my children used to appear for the exam, they get marks, I will just see, keep quiet. I have seen many parents, because I came from a teacher's family, I understood what it is. But I have seen parents, they will retotal it. Okay? They retotal, not the child. The child is very happy to play outside. Oh, teacher has not given one mark here. In programming, there is one mark less. Out of 10, she has given 9. But it is a real problem. Programming is really right. So she or she should get 10. Next day they come with that, sir, you should give my child, or madam, you should give 10 marks. Okay? Due to some reason, you know what happens while correcting paper, even as a teacher, I know. For us, between 9 and 10, there is not much difference. It is very, very good. Okay. Logically, handwrite, everything is good. Give 10. Little bit of the difference is there, give 9. Okay, that's the way. Normally, I never used to give 10 marks to anybody. Always keep them a little low. Always we prefer to give, as a teacher, you don't want to give 100 out of 100 in language at least. No language other than Sanskrit you can get 100 out of 100. Because language is individual taste. In mathematics and all, you cannot help it because logically you should do that one. But still, if the child gets 99, parents said, I have seen so many parents telling their child, the child comes with the report, I got 95. Instead of being happy for 95, where did you lose the remaining 5 marks? Don't ever do that. You know, if you burn them when they are young, they will be burnt out by the time they come to college. And you regret for that. Don't make your child burnt out by the age of 14 or 16 or 18. They have big life ahead. You want your child to... What is your aim in life, actually? You should question that. What is your aim in life? I want my child should get always first rank. It is not possible. Because this world has many bright people, many scoring people, many good people. Not that nobody can remain in the zenith for a long time. Nobody, including Bill Gates. Nobody can remain. Because Mother Earth, Kalidasa says in his in one of his classics, Bahuratnani Vasundhara, he says, oh Mother Earth, you have many Kohinoor diamonds with you. Not one Kohinoor, many Kohinoor diamonds. So, your child has many things which is inside. Don't ever think why the child lost 5 marks. Be happy he got 95. That means almost 5 marks he missed to the perfection. Be happy. Don't go on adding marks and quizzing the teacher why he should not get 10 out of 10, 9 out of 10. Okay, teacher will say, okay, take one more mark, doesn't matter. But by the time you know you do, your child observes. Please remember, role models are not Sudha Murthy. Role models to your children are parents. How your mother talks, what lies she tells, not the father is later, first is mother. That's what we call a mother tongue. And every mother thinks the child is her extension of her body. It's a reality. When the child cries, why mother? The child is crying, mother is not crying. Nothing happened to mother. The child is hurt, but mother cries. Because every woman, it's biologically and psychologically, the child is extension of her body. If something happens to the child, mother cannot take it. That's a very unusual, unconditional love God has gifted between mother and a child. So you have more responsibility than father. Than father. Whatever you do, your child will absorb that like a sponge. Suppose you lie on the telephone. The child says, okay, that is the correct way. You and I should do that. If you compare 95 to 100, when the child grows big to, you know, and gets a job, he compares himself or herself with his colleague, what promotion he got. Today you compare for marks, tomorrow they compare for grading, or they compare for the promotions, salary. It is nothing like, I don't say you should not compare. Where you are needed to compare, to learn something new, yes, you have to compare. With whom you have to compete then? You have to compete within yourself. The most important is you have to compete within yourself. Like last year, everyone knows what is my good and bad. Everybody knows. You can fool people, but inside you know what is good and what is your weak area. You know, my children used to tell me, Amma, you are very weak mother. I said, what is the definition of a strong mother? When the child doesn't listen, she will see that, she will make him or her to listen. I said, no. Every mother is a weak, because that is the weakest link is a mother actually, mother's affection. Mother should be strong in certain good in value system, like smoking is just not allowed at any cost. It is not allowed. Drug is not allowed at any cost. Telling lie is not allowed at any cost. Not respecting elders is not allowed at any cost. Rest. I want to see 10 minutes TV, 5 minutes TV. Just allow 10 minutes means give 10 or 12 minutes and switch it off. Don't say that, no, you can't see 10 minutes TV. Then child will see neighbor's house and go with 30 minutes TV. So 10 minutes TV, beta, TV is not good to see at this young age. It will affect your eyes. It will affect your eyes. And you know, more than that, let us learn a communication. Other day I was in my friend's house and they said, after many years we all of us met in the US. We said, let the family meet. Everybody came. I went early. I said, there's some 5 minutes time is there. I opened up my iPad and did something. Meantime, another friend came. He thought, oh, others have not come. He took his iPhone and he discovered something. Third person came. Oh, not all of them have come. He opened his iPad and did something. So in 10 minutes, many people came, but assuming that nobody has come, everybody were in an iPhone, laptop, everything. Then I said, if this is a get-together, why have get-together? If your gadgets, you are busy with the gadgets all the time, and then why have get-together? Because the advantage of gadget is efficiency. It's a great efficient tool, but tool is not all in all life. Sweet or a dessert is very, very nice. Jalebi is very nice to eat, but you cannot fill your stomach only by jalebi. Life is like a thali. Please remember, life is like a thali. In thali, what do you eat? A normal vegetarian thali, I can tell because I'm a vegetarian. One cup of rice, one bowl of rice, two chapati, one dal, one sabji, one raita, dahi, one sweet, two papad, and little achar. This is a normal thali. When you eat this kind of a food, you feel full at the end of the meal. Even though you may like achar a lot, you can't fill up your stomach with achar. You may like jalebi, you cannot fill up. You may like rice, but you cannot fill up. Okay? The combination of all makes life full. So is human life. Your child may be very good in one thing, but see that he or she will have other parts of the thali. Then only life becomes beautiful. Your child may have an aptitude for drawing. Don't curb it. It is not that, you know, in my work I have seen so many people, actually, particularly in radio jockeys, when I talk to them, most of them are BE. I said, beta, why you did BE and came to radio jockey? He told me, my parents wanted I should become an engineer. And I became, and later at 21, 22, I realized my mind is not in it. So I came back. Dramatics, I have seen so many people who are basically engineers. And I have a photographer, Mandanna. He's an excellent photographer. He said, I did my BE, M.Tech, and by the time I was 24, I realized I'm not fit for this. Please allow your child to bloom what they want. But legally, ethically, it should be right. I want to be a chore. Okay, that is not correct. No? That is what I like. No, that is not correct. But legally, ethically, it should be right. And also, to some extent, you have to tell commercially viable. Because it's nice to be a good artist. But you cannot live only by art in today's competitive world. You do require money to live. So you should marry between commercial and what you like as much as possible. And such life has much more meaningful and they enjoy more. So as a child, as a mother, I want to tell you, don't compare your child's marks with someone else's. You are introducing unnecessary tension to your child. I have seen in school teenagers like 13, 14 having BP because all the time they're worried, if I don't get a first rank, one boy told me, it is not my problem if I don't get first rank. My mom will be crying whole day. To make her happy, I should get a first rank. No, don't do that. And first rank and all does not have real lot of meaning in real life. You know, as a child, you nice to feel that way. You should always get a first rank. But someday I realized it is good to get good marks. It is good to work hard. But that is not all in all in life. What you require in life is like a thali meal. You should be intelligent enough to understand the reality, understand the relevance of life, understand what I can do, what I cannot do. You know, there is nothing like, you know, people say, oh, there is no word I cannot do. Napoleon used to say, there is no word no in my dictionary. That is good for Napoleon, and I don't know what he really told. There are certain things you cannot do. Okay? Such things you should not get into that, actually. Certain things you can improve. certain things you can definitely excel. Studies are in your hand, you can excel. Results are not in your hand. Because it is grading is done by someone else in a CBSE, ICSE paper that you cannot tell, okay, I have done well. At the most you can do. Our education system also makes us to do question to answer. But please remember, you have to have compassion. You have to, you have to teach your children compassion when very young age. A discipline. The most important is a discipline in life. Love for the country. Love for the country. And studies, hard working. But love for the country you should teach. In any of the national anthem or anything is there, if the child doesn't stand up, you should tell the child, if you don't stand up, my mom is to do. If there's a national anthem anywhere, you have to stand up. If you don't stand up, no dinner on that day. Whatever may be your condition, no dinner. So for me, national anthem was associated with the dinner, actually. Okay? As a child. But it became a discipline. Later I realized why. Because as a child, children won't understand the importance of that. But later, they appreciate that. So in general, what I want to tell parents is, don't pressurize. Don't live your children's life through their life. Don't live. I did not become a doctor. Let my child become a doctor. No. To become a doctor was your dream. It may not be her dream. What you cannot complete, they can't complete. Because they may like, may not like. They may complete also. But don't live your life through your dreams through them. Don't ever do that. Because every individual has a life, has liking, has their own way of leading life. Like everybody should run their own marathon. You cannot make your child to run the marathon which you wanted. So what other parents you can do is, you can encourage, discourage bad values, encourage good values, and then allow them to question. I wrote this book, Serpent Revenge and Other Stories, because as a child I used to ask so many questions, and my parents, my grandparents did not know the answer. They said, don't ask questions in Mahabharata and all, because they themselves did not know. So I just kept my questions with me, and when I grew up, I read about 10 to 20 different Mahabharatas and logically deducted what it could have been the answer. So you should always encourage children to ask questions, and if you do not know answers, don't act. Tell, I do not know. There is nothing wrong. There is no sarvajna in life. There is nobody who knows everything. There is no one. Second thing, today there is a Google. If you don't tell, they will Google and find out, and they will tell, oh, mom told me a lie. Don't get into that. Say, beta, I do not know. I will see that. I will read and I will get back to you. So it is not easy to be a parent, actually. It is quite a responsible job. But it is also a joyous job. You can see the creativity of a child from a toddler to an LKG to first standard, questioning habits, and then passing the examination, and then turning out to be a fine lady or gentleman. It's such a beautiful, see a small plant growing up to a big tree. You can witness that. And what you can do is affectionately to look after without expecting anything from them. Please remember, you are not a money lender. I spent so much money on you, and in my old age you should return. No. We bring up children for our joy. We brought them up, we have to bring them up. It's such a beautiful joy. It's a God's gift to us. Also, it's a responsibility. And if you understand what to do, what not to do, I'm sure you will have a great journey with your children. As a mother, I want to tell you, girls will not listen to you after 14 years. Girls will, about 12, 13 years, girls become little upset, may not tell everything, but they become great friends after 19. Okay? Boys will be very affectionate to mothers up to 14. Okay? After that, they have their whole world, and they look down upon cricket is the greatest thing, other things are less, and all those, because it's all cycles, you know. So enjoy your boys up to 14. Enjoy your girls after 19. Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to address both of you. And in case you have any questions, in my limited knowledge, and my answers are highly subjective. Okay? It is not, from any group theory I have taken, I will try to answer. Thank you once again.
How do we convey our message to our parents?
Please sit down. You should talk it out, even though they may not like it. Parents, I used to tell my daughter that about you, someone should not come and tell me. About you, you should tell yourself. You want to tell anything, parents? Parents, keep the channels open, don't close. Closing is the worst thing in life. If the child is scared of you, that's the worst thing in life. Then they will tell somebody. Or who can tell them the best advice other than mother? So please keep the channels open. You may not like it at times. Many times actually, you don't like it. Okay, but allow them to talk to you. And explain to them in case you are not happy, why. Children are very logical, they understand why you cannot accept. And when you accept, with your conditions. Please keep the channel open. You should not make them get scared. I'm scared to tell my mother means there's something is gone wrong. Don't do that. Parents, keep the channels open. Children, even though mother scolds you, but still you have to talk to her, because that is the only, everything in this life has a price. Anything, including this bottle, everything has a price, except mother's love. It is one thing which is priceless, which is unconditional. She may get upset now. After 5 minutes, she'll be all right. Mothers, don't get upset. Even though you are upset, don't show at that moment. You cool down and accept it. Don't show you are very upset and, you know, crying, beating. Don't do that. First, you listen. If you're upset, okay, beta, I'll talk to you after half an hour. By half an hour, you also cool down. Because it's very natural when you're young, you get upset. You know, at my age, I don't get upset because my age is also an advantage. So, please don't show you are upset. Talk to them. If you're upset, talk after half an hour. After half an hour, you'll be normal. Yes.
Good afternoon, ma'am. So, I just wanted to ask you, what drew you to philanthropy?
In India?
In India.
In Maharashtra? In no. Karnataka? Where do you want?
In India. Okay. I've read all about your books and it really inspires me how all over India you've done so much for the underprivileged and all these people. So, I just wanted to know.
Yeah, I work all over India, including Jammu Kashmir. Please sit down, beta. Northeast, everywhere. For the last 20 years we are working, and we are working school children, building schools, building toilets actually. My first project was building toilets. We built 14,000 toilets. 14,000 toilets. 4,000 flood houses. Handled 7 national calamities like earthquake, tsunami, floods, drought, in every field. Right now we are working in drought. In south of Maharashtra we started working. So we work in different area for the last 20 years. And that I like that job. And that's the reason I say every day is a holiday for me. Because I like my job so much.
Good afternoon, ma'am. So in one of your quotes, you had said that you don't have a syllabus in life, you don't have a question paper, right? You had said in one of your quotes...
No, I didn't get... Come again.
One doesn't have a syllabus in life nor a question paper. Miss, but how don't you have a model answer paper, miss? Because the experiences that you learn from others, doesn't that become a model answer?
In life, there is no perfect answer. See, in college and school, you have syllabus. Okay, between this and this chapter, if you read, you know how to answer. And you know examination dates also. After you pass out after your degree and go to a job, every day there is a crisis. Some days you may not have crisis. Some days you get all the crisis in one day. The ability to handle crisis, if you learn, then you will not have problem. Don't expect life will be very smooth. It's only in a movie. You meet a hero and get married. He will win a big job. Everything is fine. One day the villain comes. In real life, not that. You may be a very good worker. Your colleagues may not be good with you. You may be an excellent daughter-in-law. Mother-in-law may be a little nasty. Okay, these are all part of life. But nobody remains. Please remember, every difficulty is a helium balloon. It is not I have told. This one Dimple Kapadia told, I liked it. Every difficulty in life is a helium balloon. And sometimes it stays with you and then it goes up. This is, she is not a graduate, but the kind of statement she made, I liked it a lot. So please remember, in real life, undefined problems will come. If you are intelligent, you don't have to have your own experience. Okay, I will fail and I will learn. No. I will see somebody has some difficulty, how they passed out, or how they failed. Learn from them, and if you incorporate, you are a very smart person. If that failure affects you and you learn from your own hard work, you are an average person. Even though you fail and if you don't learn, then you are really a dull person. These are the three classes in real life. Learn from others' mistake, learn from your own mistake, don't learn from your own mistake. So try to become number one, learn from others' mistake. And if not possible, learn from your own. Don't ever think of the third degree. Okay, fine.
Miss, as a writer, what writing advice would you like to give?
As a writer, what advice?
Writing advice.
Writing
tips to give.
Tips. I think other day I told, one is, to be a writer, you should read a lot. Actually, you should read a lot. You should every day make it a habit to read, actually. Then, about at least 50 pages a day. New book, not the same book. Okay? Every day, actually, I did like that when I was a young girl of your age. Every day, I used to write 25 lines of my own. Anything, my own. Like I went to the market, I saw these things, I came back, I helped my mother in the kitchen, like a diary. In our time, we had a diary. Today, that concept of diary is not there. So every day I have to write diary and you can't write a story every day. So 25 lines every day I used to write. For several years, it improved A, my handwriting, B, my communication skills. So every day if you read, that helps you a lot to understand somebody's difficulties. Second thing is, you should be a very sensitive person. If some beggar is on the road, and if you are not sensitive, then you don't even bother. The most sensitive human being ever produced was Buddha, who was a prince, saw someone of suffering and became a monk. Other was the Jesus Christ. He saw people are suffering from leprosy, and he gave up his life to give them medicine, or to to help them. People who are sensitive care for others. But nobody can become a Buddha or a Jesus Christ. That is the highest point. We are all normal people. Care for others, be sensitive, absorb the relevance, and do read every day. That makes you probably a writer. But initially what you write, you should not publish. Just write it and keep for some time. The reason is, when you are 16 or 18, your ideas are not matured. They are not practical. When you grow older and see, so more difficulties, actually people who see a lot more difficulties can write better because they know what is in somebody else's mind. If you are always, you have always money, you are always successful, then you may not be able to understand people who are not successful, what is their mindset. So you have to undergo all these difficulties to write better. And that is the reason I spend about 5 days in a year, just to understand what people feel. 5 days in a year, what I do, in a temple, I wash vessels. I don't do any other work except washing temple vessels, cooking vessels, etc., and cleaning the floor 5 days in a year, because it makes me to understand how a poor man lives on such job and what are their aspirations in life. Once in a year, I travel by local bus for 2 or 3 days. Okay? Otherwise, I will never come to know. I'll be insulated from people because the kind of facility I have, I'll be insulated from the real world. It should not happen. And once in a year, or maybe twice in a year, I go by second class without reservation. Because I should know what life it is for common man. If you don't understand what is the life of a common man, you will never be able to understand their difficulties. It seems Henry Ford's daughter, granddaughter, you know that story, I suppose. Henry Ford's granddaughter was in a school and the teacher told, write something about poverty. She did not know what to write because she was Henry Ford's granddaughter. She came back and wrote, There was a couple, they were extremely poor, they had only 5-bedroom house. They had a car which was only 1-year-old model. They had only one cook and one driver. With that poor condition, they continued for some time. There is nothing wrong in her because she has not seen what life is. So I would tell you, you must experience difficulties. You should mix with people, understand what they feel. And this is what life we lead, is not a real life. Understanding someone's life is also equally important. That makes you a better writer.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am. Ma'am, what inspires you to do so much every day? Like, what is your inspiration?
My schedule every day.
Your inspiration?
My inspiration are poor people, actually. My inspiration are poor people because when I look at them, I always say, everybody wants to be born in a rich family. Everybody wants. Because it's a natural desire, no? You get good education, good food, good facility, everything. But there is an invisible line between poor and rich. Why people are born there, we do not know. There is not invisible, there is a visible line. There is somebody's decision that why somebody has to be born in that family, in that line and why here. And we don't have control on that. So people who are born that side of the line, they may be as talented as you are, but they have less opportunity. And as a human being, I feel, I personally feel, I don't require that kind of a wealth to lead a normal life. Actually, in real life, people have a lot of mistake, you know, misunderstandings regarding wealth. You have a lot of money, you live happily. No, money is only a facilitator in life. But you cannot eat golden rice. You eat the same rice. You really don't require the huge wealth to be happy in life. You require a mindset to be happy in life. So I always feel the money which is given to me, I'm a daughter of a school, college professor, doctor, and granddaughter of a school teacher, which was a middle class life. And I think when the money was given to me, it has given for a real cause in life. The cause is to help people on the other side. And that's the main strength or inspiration for me.
I need to start writing books.
When I started writing, as a schoolgirl of your age, I used to write a diary, 25 lines a day. Maybe I was 8 years old, I think. I started writing 8 years old, 9 years old, only 25 lines. By 16 or 17, I used to write good essays, actually. I remember when I was 16, I wrote the India, people who are born after death of Gandhi. I wrote something, the India I have seen, I won't remember the title now, after death of Gandhi, what I see in India or something, like imaginary things. But I never published anything. When I was 20, I think I started publishing short stories, small one. But my first book came when I was 28. But I wrote maximum number of books in the last 20 years because with Infosys Foundation, I started going to all corners of India, meeting film actress, politicians, prostitutes, Devadasis, Kamatipura, schools, army navy camps, Ladakh region, northeast region, so, and working in hurricane. All these experiences taught me the reality of life, and I could write more. But I started my first book, I think, was published when I was 28, I think.
Ma'am, this question sort of...
Actually, I'm so happy. One boy is asking question. Look at girls, they're so smart. I always believe girls are smarter than boys.
Ma'am, this one question is actually from an older brother, like, as my role is an older brother. How do you tell someone that you're there to help them? And when they ask you questions, how do you help them out?
No, I didn't get. If somebody asked me to help, how do I help?
Yeah. And how do you explain to someone that you're actually there to help them and not to, like, just stand and watch?
Okay. Please sit down. What, you know, in the Infosys Foundation, we get 400 calls a day, altogether incoming, outgoing, 400, around 350 emails. And about 200 letters or something. It's a huge, actually. we get. We have our own process of elimination first. We elimination, we do that. I'll tell you a story before that. Once, I don't know whether I have told this to some lecture or not, I don't remember. Once about 15 years back, I was called the chief guest to one music program. And normally I go a little early than the schedule because I don't like to go late. It's a bad manners. Even today I think 5 minutes I was earlier than the schedule because I don't like to go late. So I went that day 15 minutes early. I sat in the corner at the back, you know, and there were hardly few people because I was quite early. Two women, well-off women, with their diamond earrings and silk sari and all sitting and talking, and they were making remarks. My daughter is very dull. The second one told, how she will get married, I'm worried. Said, no, put, she should take up a job, then the boys like a girl who is employed. So she said, yes, yes, I was thinking. She said, okay, why can't she become a teacher? Then she told, no, I sent her to school and they said she's not capable, sent her back. Then she said, oh, tell her to do some social work. Then the other lady said, is it that easy? Yeah, yeah, it's very easy. You have not seen Sudha Murthy? Every day she comes in the paper. Her husband has earned money. She doesn't have a brain. So that's okay. That's okay. That's okay. That's what they think. So she writes a check. Every day she comes in the paper. So your daughter can become a social worker like her. I said, okay, now let me talk, you know, because there's something connected to me. So I tapped their shoulders and said, have you seen Sudha Murthy? Have you met her? Oh, of course we met her. They said, when did you meet her last? Today morning. I said, same Narayan Murthy's wife? They said, yes. I said, I'm Sudha Murthy. No, that lady looks at me and tells, oh, you have changed so much from morning to evening. I told her, no, I want to clarify certain things with you. That's the reason I have talked to you. Don't ever look down upon teaching job. A teacher is the most respected job I ever think in any compared to any job because they are creating characters. And that's the greatest thing. Look at software people. What do we create? Only programs. Whereas a teacher creates that many characters. Don't ever look down upon that. I said, if a doctor makes a mistake, the patient will go 6 feet below the ground. If a magistrate makes a mistake, the person will be hung 6 feet above the ground. If a teacher makes a mistake, the entire batch is wiped out. And it is such a sacred job. Don't ever look down upon that. Coming to social work. I said, just because one has money, one won't become social worker. One can be a donor. You know, a person sits in front of me in 10 minutes, I should measure whether he or she is eligible for the help what you give. It is only a lip sympathy we talk. If I am giving money, how much I should give and when I have to stop. That means I have to assess a person sitting in front of me in 10 minutes. It's not like 10 days or something time I don't have because I will have 17 appointments a day. So when a person comes to meet us and asking money, before that we do homework. For what they are asking, I have a loan of 50,000, we don't give. I'm building a mandir, church or a masjid, we don't give. I'm a Brahmin. I said it is not a criteria to be in life. You belong to one or the community. I'm a Kannadiga, very good, but we don't give any money. I belong to Congress or BJP, we don't give any money to such. So we go on eliminating first. Then it comes to hardcore. In that, if we help a person, we don't do any lip sympathy. Oh, I'm there with you, or such things, we don't talk. We give, we don't give. If we give, with the condition we give. If you don't give, there's nothing to give. Then, if we want to give, we go on a simple principle. If I help for a project, is it going to help lots of poor people in that area? Bahujana hitaya, bahujana sukhaya. If I help, you know, people ask us, I got an admission in Harvard, will you help us? I said, no. In the same money, I rather give 20 children who are doing engineering. Because one fellow going to Harvard doesn't make any difference to me. But I rather make 20 engineers who are more useful to their families and the country. So larger effect or impact on a larger people is always our criteria. And that's the way we go on assessing things. Then before that, we do a lot of homework. Suppose I want to give something to a hospital. Before that, we say, who are the people? Who are the trustees? How are the trustees? Are they corrupt? Who are the beneficiaries? Okay, all the studies we do, it's like a horoscope kind of study we do, and then we give. So in our work, if I have 100 hours, I almost spend 70 to 75 hours on investigation and 25 hours only on execution. Like writing a check takes 2 minutes actually. Then after giving the check, then we have a milestone. First year how they did, second year how they did, third year how they did. So we want all the reports. Then we send a third party inspection how work they have done. So it's quite a complicated, but we do a lot of work before we give money.
Arsh.
Okay, tell me.
I've read a few of your books and I want to ask the question if they are really based on your life and they have a real meaning.
Which book you have read?
I've read The Secret of the Lost Temple, I think.
Okay, I'll tell you a story about it. I know the real things I will tell you. There are some books which are 100% real or 99% real. 1% I change the name, make the situation different. Wise and otherwise, the day I stopped drinking milk, how I taught my grandmother to read, they're all real. The Old Man and His God, they're all real stories. For children, Grandma's Bags of Stories, Magic Drum, The Bird with the Golden Wings, they're all imaginary. Whereas this book, The Magic of the Lost Temple, is 50%. I have a granddaughter by the name Anushka, and she is 4 years old. I'm assuming when she's 10, she'll be like what I have written there. And the grandmother in that is me. Okay, that is me. And that was my granddaughter. And I lived in a village, but now I live in Bangalore. I assumed I go back and live in my village, and Anushka comes from Bangalore. How I will interact with her? They're all real, but imagination is I'm going to village. The pure imagination in that story is the Somanayaka temple, there are three temples, right? Yes. That's all imagination. 50% is truth, 50% is imagination. That's for Nooni I wrote, and even there I call her a Nooni in that. Yeah. Thank you for this.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Where are you, beta? Huh?
Yes, miss. Huh. Miss, I would like to ask you, would you like to share with us some of your experience with Infosys?
Which one? I have written that in some, one of my books, but which one you call?
I really don't know the name. Can you just tell anyone which you like?
It's hard to tell, but I can tell you, starting Infosys with a 10,000 rupees journey, I never ever thought or dreamt we'll become famous, rich, nothing I dreamt. We took it as an adventure and we started. The journey was more beautiful than the results. We did, of course, we became famous, we got money, etc. But the journey itself, without expecting anything, that journey itself was beautiful. And I think in one of my book I have written that I will do it is one lesson I remember. Other one is a mother's advice. Maybe my mother told me in life where to spend, where not to spend. That's one another. I suppose that's all I remember. But the journey of Infosys itself was a beautiful journey where, you know, we had very little money, but we had a lot of confidence because we never ran after money. Please remember, if you ran after money runs away from you. If you run after good work, money comes behind you. And that's what Infosys is, that we ran after a good value system. And money came. But if you wanted to make, we never thought of making big money, etc. My idea when we started Infosys was, I want to have a scooter and a 2-bedroom apartment. That's all my aim was there at that time. I never aimed money in my life at all, any moment of time. Because money never fascinated me. It is the book which fascinated me. It is the knowledge which fascinated me. It is the children who they fascinated me. So my fascinations were so different. So money never fascinated me. So the journey of Infosys was more of our value system, how we ran. and with absolutely no money and absolutely nothing, we felt bad also. I used to drive the car. Later we had a car. I was a driver for a long time to drop everybody, pick up everyone. Then we all stayed in one house. Rodi Nilekani, myself, and Sudha Gopalakrishnan. We used to cook. I never used to cook. They used to cook, but I used to take the food. So we lived like a joint family for some time. And my children were looked after by Rohini Nilekani. They will not do office work, whereas I will do my office work. She will do other work. As I used to be, if programmer is on leave, I will go and do programming. After all, it was a journey of our five fundamental founders lived in a joint family, or different language, different community, different state, lived like one family, and lived with a value system. And that's what I can call our journey.
Can we open the questions to the parents, please? Just raise your hand and I'll...
Yeah. Because last time, I could not answer students in crossword. I was feeling very bad. It was already 9:30. So I thought this time, let me talk to children themselves. Okay.
Ma'am, it's a pleasure to hear you today.
Pardon? Yes.
Ma'am, it's a pleasure to hear you today. And thanks, PTA, for organizing this. I really appreciate the qualities you said, that you wash vessels once in a year and do those kind of things to know what is happening. I would like to know your suggestions on for the school kids, what they can do in a year to keep themselves on the ground and be more aware about what is happening in the world.
You should do that, not they.
Yeah, you so should. We. I agree.
See, what happens? Suppose you want your children should be aware of the reality, right? Okay, this is a way, this is a high, please sit down. This is a subjective way of telling, but how I did, I can tell you. My child came and told me, Amma, in our school there is a birthday party. I think there's a birthday party in a big way, I suppose, nowadays. There's a birthday party, my son, my friend's house, they take us to some five-star restaurant. Some well-off parents can take. There's nothing wrong because everybody has their way of doing birthdays. There is nothing, I will comment on that, going to five-star hotel is less or not good or nothing of that sort. That is their parents' wish. He went once, I think his classmate's birthday was there, and my child, Rohan, my son, went to birthday party, came and said, Amma, it was so good, and my birthday, I want to take. I said, no, Bill, you can't take. He said, why? I said, Rohan, please remember, how much it will cost, let us talk about it. Each child, let us take 1,000 rupees. You call about 50 people, your class. How much it costs? 50 into 1,000. Is how much? 50,000 rupees. He said, Rohan, please remember. You know, I told there was a person who used to come and drive our car. I said, he has two children. They are as bright as you are. Okay? Their school fees are probably in those days 10,000. If you give 20,000 to them, they can go to a better school, beta. For your birthday, I'm not denying you should not do, etc. I will buy samosa, okay? I will buy samosa and rasna packet, or nimbu sharbat, something there. No, mango drink was there. What is that? Maza, not maza. Fruity. Yeah. Fruity, in those days. I'm talking about 25 years back. So, I will spend for 50 children, plus our driver's children, everyone, you know, altogether this much money. More than that, I think you should not spend, because you what you are doing is wrong according to me. Those two children will not go to school, whereas you spend 50,000. And he didn't like it. What I said, he didn't like it. He said, oh, you always give me hishob, that means you always give me plus minus, always a balance sheet. I said, think over it, I will give you 3 days' time. And after 3 days, he came back and said, okay, I agree, but along with samosa, you should give us one gulab jamun or something. I said, fine. Okay? So I told, and in front of him, I gave 10,000 to our driver's children, in front, through his hand. I said, Bill, from your account, there's a 50,000 rupees. Out of that, this is the way you're spent. This much money is left, and this you should give it to some good cause. And I used to take my children, when I wash vessels, I used to take my children to wipe them. You have to take your children. Fortunately, I had a job like this, where I go to Lambani tribal area, etc. I used to take my children. Come with me. I can show you they are very good children there. they don't have an opportunity. Is it not your duty? So he, I used to tell me, you make me so guilty, Amma, to spend any money. And today, because every time he'll bring one case like that. So today he says, Amma, what you did was a fantastic education, that when we spend so much money, we never think of someone else. And that sense of caring for others. You know, for example, you know, we have a cook, and cook always gets food. So the cooks normally used to eat in the kitchen. I told one day, Rohan, I was talking about equality in life or some topic. When they become 14, 16, I treated them like adult. Just like adult. At least after 14 boys, after 16, no, girls also 13 only have to do now, 1 year early. I treated them like adults, and we'll have a conversation on a dining table. I talked about equality, and I was talking about slavery in America. Equality is so important in life. Then he said, Amma, if that is equality, will our drivers, will our cook eat on the same table as ours? For a minute, I never thought about it. I said, yeah, why not? And he made it a point, our cooks eat at the same dinner table. But our cooks are hesitating. No, we don't want to eat. Then, you know, I made a samsota. Like, you can eat after we eat. If you feel like eating, no, you don't want to eat with us. At least you sit, use the dining table and eat on the dining table. It may be a small move, but that made a lot of awareness for my children, equality in life. When he was in our Cornell school, Rohan's birthday came, and I was thinking he was abroad in those days, what he will do. I would have been unhappy. This is my subjective opinion. If he spends so much money on a birthday, which comes every year, why waste that kind of money? It is not something like fantastic thing. It is not like we are Mahatma Gandhi, born on October 2nd. We are ordinary people. We are just ordinary people. Let us not think that we are too great. If somebody says, oh, what do you think of yourself? I said, I'm a very ordinary person. Very ordinary person, but the situation made me great. The situation made me great. I'm very ordinary than like anybody else. You should bring up this idea with your children's mind. Look, my child, you are ordinary. Just because your father has money or I have money, you are not extraordinary. Money comes due to various reasons. Okay? And money, what you have, has a cause. That I made it to my children in a very young age. And when he was in Cornell, he wrote to me, and I have that email even today. He said, every mother works, every mother looks after her child, but I'm proud my mother looks after someone's children. Isn't that the best compliment I can think of? He got a scholarship. Then he got a scholarship, and he sent the very little money. He must have had 1 lakh rupee or something, you know. Not great money. He wrote to me, Amma, this money should be spent on my birthday to all those jawans who died in a parliament attack in 2001. They died there so that we can live in free democratic India. It is not a big money. It is not a big money. But that idea of sharing wealth with somebody, idea of being sensitive to someone is poor and they have a right to live, and making equality along with our own driver and cook, you know, such ideas you have to initiate to your children. That is very important. Most of the time we don't do that, because we think what others will think, what is the status. Suppose my neighbor comes, my cook is eating on the dining table, what they think of us. You know, all those false values, all those tightened compartments we build around what people think. Let them think what they think. You cannot live on people's opinion. You have to live on your own opinion. And that you should understand to tell your children. Children will be, for many years, children will carry your values. Later, once they are married, their wife's value. Once they are exposed to different values, you know, that goes on changing. But to some extent, great extent, you can reflect it. Yes, please.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yeah. This lady wants a yellow dress. She wants to ask. Yeah.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Who is that?
Ma'am, this is your good afternoon. Thank you. It's a lovely afternoon. You have given us a very beautiful lecture as well as a very good knowledge. My last question, like probably there may be many parents like me must be wanting to ask questions. One challenge which I'm facing these days is gadgets. So how to correlate a story to have a restrictions on the gadget on my children or many parents like me?
I'm sure.
Thank you.
I'll tell you. Sometimes I say, thank God, my children are not born in this age, you know. What are the gadgets we will have? iPhone. Phone is the most culprit, right? iPhone, iPad, laptop.
Television.
Let's take only four. What is the age group of your children? Oh, still you can control, okay. Up to 18 you can manage somehow. Once they go to college, it becomes hard. But again, you know, okay, 10 and 13 still you can manage. Put the switch off TV, you don't see TV. Put off, sell the TV, no see TV at home. Or if you have TV and they're really fond of TV, as a dessert, 10 minutes. Okay, as a dessert, okay, put it off. Second thing, you have to tell children why not TV. Because once I told some film actor that one, anything, I can give a sermon, two people will understand. I can write a book, 10 people will read. If I act in a movie, thousands of people will understand. That's the reason Dangal is very, very good social message, because entire country celebrates the birth of a daughter now. So, what you see in television, children absorb it with a high density. Most of the serials, with all ornament, fake though, maybe fake, lot of ornament, big sindoor, and actually I'm wondering who wears that kind at home. I've never seen somebody wearing. And that chakpaki ka sari, red color, pink color, black border. And I wonder how do they work at home with that kind of a sari, because even with salwar kameez, they're so hard to work at home. And they must be having 10 cooks at home, I feel, when I look at that. They're all unrealistic. You have to tell children, beta, they will make money. To make that money, they will add all these spices. But in real life, no family lives like that. So, I went to somebody's house. It was about 15 years, 20 years back actually. That day it was a Draupadi Vastra Paharana was there. And my friend's daughter was getting married. So she said, Sudha, the marriage at 6 o'clock. I said, what, 6 in the morning? December 6 in Bangalore means temperature is 10 degrees, 12 degrees. Who will come for Murta? She said, the Pandit said, today the Draupadi Vastra Paharana, 9 o'clock is serial, and 6 o'clock is one Murta, other Murta is at 9 o'clock, and I will not conduct your daughter's wedding. 6 o'clock was the wedding Murta. So, you should see TV, but to not an extent become addictive or its slave. It may be TV, it may not be TV. In general, slavery is bad. It could be for gutka, it could be for cigarette, it could be for alcohol. Because, you know, my next book is going to come with alcohol anonymous work, you know, how people become alcoholic, how women become alcoholic, how children, parents, seeing that children become, so on that I'm writing an essay, and for that I'm working on with alcohol people now. What makes them? They say any addiction is bad. It may be too much work, too much movie, too much television, too much eating. Anything too much is bad. Don't think TV, watching TV is bad. Anything too much is bad. Anything too much is very bad. And that you have to tell children. Look, even I like to see, but I'm not seeing because I feel it's a waste of time. It don't happen in one day. It takes some time. And then they appreciate. Now coming to iPhone, iPad. Okay? As a children, no, if they don't require, don't buy iPad. If they don't require, don't buy iPad. Don't give birthday gifts as an iPad, iPhone, don't give. Tell me 10, 13 years why they require a phone. Give me one reason why do they require a phone. You want to call someone, call on the landline. Whom they can talk, you have to say that, why do you require a phone? Phone is meant for those people who are extremely busy, they have to communicate something. You are going to school going child, why do you require it? So you say, I require phone only to talk when it's needed. You don't talk 2 hours on telephone to your mother, sister. You should not do that. I always tell, I will not talk to you for 2 hours. If I want to talk when children sleep, my sister is abroad, we want to talk sometime. When children sleep at 4 o'clock in the morning, today morning also, that habit has continued with me. If I have to talk to my brother and sister who are abroad, 4 in the morning I will call before children get up. 4 o'clock, 4 a.m. to 4:30. Because I want to communicate, but I don't want my children to say, you talk to your mother and brother half an hour and you tell us not to talk to my friends. Children give you that kind of a reply because they see. First, you have to restrain and tell children anything too much is bad. It is not TV. It is not iPad. Any habit, if you go in deep is always bad. Okay, that's the one way. Second thing is, you sit with them and start reading with them. Nothing like reading, nothing like quiz. Okay, or I will tell you half story, you continue, or you tell me what happened in the class. Okay, and you know, you have to take, you have to keep a channel open, talking about the your school, your teacher, and they may use saying the teacher was not good. Never ever encourage such things. No, teacher is always right. Maybe you have mistaken. Never ever tell child your teacher is wrong. If you feel, maybe you can talk to a teacher, but never do that in front of a child. No. Yes, beta.
Sudha ji, we are very happy to have you here, and there's a lot of extraordinariness in the ordinariness that you have projected. But let us know something about the harmonious relationship that you have with your husband, because one of the challenges that today's generation face, especially when two people are working as husband and wife, is to have a harmonious relation. I don't mean in terms of, you know, the love which is deep inside. That is what I mean to say.
No, I make a joke on that. I have a good touch wood, I have a good relationship with my husband because we hardly meet. I will tell you the answer. My husband travels 20 days in a month abroad. I travel 22 days in a month village. Okay? How many days are left? 6 to 8 days in a month. So when you are with each other for 6-8 days, why fight? Okay. No, the real reason is not that. The real reason is, this is highly subjective, and I belong to one generation behind you. Please understand, I'm one generation behind you. The value system, the marriage, the commitment are so different than what it is today. You marry for life, you know, that is the first fundamental thing. And my mother told me, when I got married, if you fight with your husband and come back, I will not open the door. You have to adjust. And I married into a big joint family, which I was not used to. But one thing I realized, as a woman, every woman feels her husband should listen to her. Every woman feels. If someone says, I don't, then it's not correct actually, because that's what we expect in marriage, my husband should listen to me. Man also feels my wife should listen to me, that we don't worry. Over a period of time, I realized a person like Murthy, who eats, breathes, drinks Infosys, cannot spare any time for us, for the family. It is like a tapas. In olden days, Rishi used to go sit in a forest and do tapas. Today, you can sit in Electronic City and do tapas. Okay? The result of that tapas is Infosys. A son of a school teacher can build an empire like Infosys in one's lifetime of 30 years. It's not a joke. That means the person should be dedicated his entire life for that, dreaming about it, talking about it. Then what is his wife's duty? Expecting him, you have to take me out for a movie, you take me out for a sari birthday, you take me out for this. None of them are possible in his life. So accept a person as he is. That is what I tell women. Accept your husband what he is. What he is not, don't imagine he should be like a Shah Rukh Khan. No. Accept your husband, that bundle. Some good points, some negative points. Because I have some plus, I have some minus. Accept your husband what he is. And the moment you accept, life becomes easy. Second thing, little bit philosophically I thought, after some time, not immediately after marriage, maybe after 5-6 years I realized, everybody, like what I told, everybody has his or her own life. I have been brought up in a different atmosphere. My father was a doctor. Murthy's father was a school teacher. There were 8 children. We are 4 children. When you are brought up in a different atmosphere, your way of looking at life is also different. Why should I accept? My husband should say this is the correct and what he was brought up is not correct. Similarly, he may be thinking about me also same way. Do not expect to see what you see through your eyes, your husband also should see the same way. The moment you please give him a liberty or freedom, what he likes. please allow him the liberty or the freedom, what he likes, why he likes, why he wants to spend money on A, B, C, D, unless it's harmful for the family. Suppose he gives a little more money to your mother-in-law, little more money to sister-in-law. Let us assume that way. You may get upset for a minute, but you should also remember, whatever said and done, you know, my husband used to do a lot more, actually. Lot more to mother-in-law, to his wife, compared to wife. Initially, as we got upset, then I realized, I knew my husband at the age of 26. First 26 years, who has taken care? She deserves more. She deserves more. Tell your mind, don't compete with her. After all, he was her son first, then my husband later. And this liberty gave me so much freedom not to contest with him for anything. And even now I tell him, look, as a friend, I feel what you are doing is wrong. As a friend, whatever projects they take, I think as a friend, if something is wrong, I tell him, as a friend, I will tell this is wrong. As a family unit, I'll accept it. Decision is yours. And I expect same thing from him. And he does that. As a friend, Sudha, this is not correct. As a family, I accept it. So allow the freedom of men, and they should allow your freedom. That's the reason behind every successful woman, behind every successful woman, there's an understanding husband.
Ma'am, you are working from so many years, actually, till this age. How do you manage so many roles? How do you try to manage so many roles in a day in your life? And did you have any guilt any day while bringing up your children and all that?
Please, Rana, no guilt at all. No guilt at all. Because I've been very clear in my thinking, consciously. One or two things I have like, I wish I could have learned yoga when I was young, but there was no yoga teacher in my village. I feel I should have learned that one. Second thing, I should have learned swimming, but I came from a village where there was scarcity of water. Forget about swimming. Okay. But by and large, no regret for me, because when you make a decision, be clear what you are going to do. Whenever you make a decision, we don't know if it's right or wrong. At that moment, it looks right. Later, it may be wrong also. Only time will tell it was right or wrong. Again, what is wrong, what is right? You know, they're all ambiguous questions. So by and large, I lead the decisions I take through my conscience. Through my conscience. So that's the reason I sleep every day, 8:30 sharp. And I'm not disturbed by any of these things. How do I manage all these things is, I enjoy my work, actually. That's why I never feel tired. I never feel tired for any of my work. Today morning I must have got up at 4 to 4:30 I made a call, then came to airport, took a plane, came here, went for a meeting. From there I have come here. After I finish this, I go to the next meeting. And up to right 11 o'clock I have meetings. After 11 o'clock I'll come home. At 12 o'clock I will reach. Then 4:30 I should get up. 6 o'clock is my flight. I never get bored. Because I love my work. When you love your work, you never get bored. Tell me a job like this where I can meet so many people, so many children, so many people, learn so much from them. How many people will have this kind of an opportunity? So I love my job, so no strain for me. Second thing is, I don't spend any time on following things. Like I have never gone to market for 20 years. I have never gone to my market for 20 years. I really don't require anything from market. I don't attend weddings. Rarely I attend weddings. Rarely. Because I really get that much time, you know, traveling for a wedding is quite a lot of time, I feel. Third thing is, I have projects in my mind, one after another. One after another. I always keep serial projects in my mind. So I go on executing them, the next one, next one. And writing gives me enormous happiness. So once I write, I'll rejuvenate myself. And I normally do not waste time in chit-chatting. There's nothing wrong in that, but I don't enjoy that. I rather convert that time for reading or anything. Basically, you should love your job, what you do. Then you are always young at heart. That's what I want to tell you.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Yes. Ma'am, as you said right now, and in one of your interviews, you said that you have not shopped for many of years. So how should we, in particular children, limit ourselves to not do something which we should not like?
No. I have not shopped for various reasons. One is, it is a custom in South India. I think my next book is going to have that essay. It is a custom in South India, when you go to Varanasi or Kashi, you should leave what you like the most. The lighter side on this is, I asked Narayan Murthy, why you have not gone to Varanasi? He told, what you like the most, you have to leave. So I have to leave you, so I can't go. It is a joke. The custom is, when you go to Kashi, you have to leave what you like the most. There's a custom in South India. My grandparents were very old and they wanted to go to Kashi and have a bath in Ganga, like any religious people in India. And they could not do it because they were in a village, they were old also. So when I grew up, I went to Varanasi on their behalf and I took water in my hand. I actually never thought about it. When the water was in my hand in the morning, and I saw sun and remembered the shloka, you know, oh sun, you are the way. My grandfather was a Sanskrit scholar, so I learned Sanskrit in a very young age. We could converse in Sanskrit with him. So I took water in my hand and I remembered the shloka, oh sun, you are the witness in the Ganges, the Ganga of our country, who is a witness for all the civilization in our land. And then it says, I leave something to you. That struck me, what will I leave? Nothing, you know, I became blank. Then I remembered, what is most important for a woman? It's shopping. Let me leave shopping forever to you, O God. That's it. After I had my bath, I came up and I said, what did I tell? I leave shopping forever in my life? How can I do that? Then my mind said, my conscience said, it is nothing is impossible in life. What is there to shop in life? It's okay. I was, I think, 45 years old. I said, you have chopped 45 years. What is there? It's only a mindset. And believe it or not, I removed my mind from shopping and I have not gone at all. Or I don't even know what is existing, what is non-existing, how much it costs, nothing. It has given me a tremendous strength to control the mind. Like how Jains do. Jains have a very fantastic way of controlling mind. And that is the best way. That what you like the most, you should leave it. But still I buy medicine, traveling, books and all those things, still I do. Some good friends give me saris, you know, once in a year or something. For the last 5 years, even I stopped taking saris also. I said, why do I need? You know, after 60, you should never accumulate anything. Because it's the time where you have to give away. So, when you make our mind, think over it and make it. Make it and then don't break it. So don't make it when you're 10, 15 years. Let it be some 35, 40 years. By the time you've seen enough in life. Yeah, last question, okay? Yes, beta. Let her ask. After all, a child. Huh.
So some of the topics that you write about and that you focus on are very serious.
Like?
Like dowry deaths. I just read Vice and Otherwise.
Uh-huh.
What inspired you to stand up for all these?
They're all real. Yeah. They're all real. I've seen dowry death. Then that's the reason I used to work in that area. Then I wrote it. What I see, I write. Okay.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
Miss, one of your stories was about how you helped two young boys who were underprivileged and moving on in life. One became a shop. He owned a
garage,
shop.
Garage fellow.
And one was a doctor.
That Bombay doctor, car doctor.
Yeah, and he charged you more in the pretext of charging less, and the other person gave you a sari for no cost. Ma'am, I just wanted your advice on how you judge people. I mean, how would you know what a person's intentions are, and how do you filter out yourself the people who mean well and people who don't?
It's very difficult actually how to know what person is, because everybody talks very sweet to you. Particularly when you have a lot of money to give, the people will be very nice to us. Okay? But if someone talks too much about me, you know, I think Ati Vinayam Durta Lakshanam. That means this fellow, you never know. Second thing, you know, if you don't expect anything, whether they give or not, doesn't matter. But by and large, you can, over a period of time with your experience, 90% of the time you can make out what is their intention. And if someone says, okay, I will do all these too many things, no, then you have to take a pinch of salt. So by and large, we realize, but sometimes we do go wrong. It's the human nature. Greed is makes, actually, it is not the people. Greed makes them to do that one. If you can make out that person has a greedy trait, then you know this fellow is going to googly to me later in life.
Did you always know you wanted to write and become an author? Was that your passion from the beginning?
Did I know diary?
Did you always know you wanted to write a book when you grew up?
No, actually, I was quite, please sit down. I was quite blank about my future when I was young. I used to read, go to school, learn, always reading. As in, I have taken life as it came. But maybe by 16, I made up my mind what I want to become. I wanted to become an engineer and I wanted to write. So at 16 or 17, I decided what I want to become. Before that, no. Before that, like a carefree. It's okay? Thank you very much.